Check, check. This is just a quick live video test. Y'all keep talking amongst yourselves. If you're watching online, please let me know if the audio sounds okay. Want to make sure everything goes well for service. Something's loud. Something's too hot. I just need to calm it. Just need to calm down.
Do you have a tendency to yell?
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning and welcome to Edgefield First Baptist Church. I'm Pastor Aaron Tripp. Thank you so much for being here today, and thank you for spreading out as much as you can. If you're a visitor with us this morning, know that we have gone back to quite a few COVID protocols. That's just to keep everyone safe as they gather in this place to worship. We're not going to have the band this morning. Of course, no Sunday school, no normal Wednesday night activities. But that is because we want to protect Sunday morning the best we can. And so we ask you to wear your mask. Use hand sanitizer as you come in and as you leave. Spread out, and we just want to do everything we can to keep you and your family safe this holiday season. If you haven't signed up for Christmas Eve service yet, please do so. But once again, I just want to welcome you into this house, and if you have any questions, please let me know.
Good morning. I don't know why I feel like I have to stand on my tiptoes every time. It's because Aaron comes first. Just a couple of announcements. Thank you for being here today. If you weren't here, I would be with Aaron by myself, and I'm really glad that you're here. So tonight is the youth Christmas party at 6:30 at my house. If it's raining and kind of bad weather, we're going to move it over to the church. So I'll text you or you'll figure it out. And so Christmas Eve is Thursday night? Thursday night is Christmas Eve. There's two service options, all right? So there's one at 4 and there's one at 6. If you would sign up for the one that you would like to attend, that would be really great. So we have an idea. We're allowing 150 people per service. So if you are like, man, I love to go to bed at 6 o'clock, sign up for the 4 o'clock one, okay? But again, thank you guys for being here today. Obviously, you know, it's hard that we can't have Sunday school or Wednesday nights, but I'm thankful that we still get to gather together as the body of Christ this morning. So let's pray. Dear Lord, I thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for your generosity and allowing us to be in your presence. Lord, I pray that this morning that we would not take that for granted. God, as we celebrate what this season means, Lord, as we talk about the meaning of love, 1 John chapter 3 comes to my mind, so that we know that it says that this is how we know what love is, Lord, that you laid down your life for us. And so, Lord, I pray that we'd be mindful of that this morning. Lord, that you came to be a sacrifice for us. Lord, that you came that we could experience what true love is. So, Lord, I pray during this service, God, that everything that is said and done would be pleasing and glorifying to you. Lord, that Aaron would bring us a message this morning that is both challenging and encouraging. Help us to reflect on the truth of your word and just be with us as we worship you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So one of my favorite Christmas songs is called I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day. And it just really kind of stuck out to me. And I sang it at the Deacon's Christmas party this past week. But it just talks about how there is a need for peace on earth. And so I'm going to sing I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day.
I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play. Mild and sweet their songs repeat, a peace on earth, goodwill to men. And the bells that ring like a choir, they're singing. Does anybody hear them? Peace on earth, goodwill to men. And in despair, I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth. Bye. chance of life. A peace on earth, goodwill to men. And the bells they ring like a choir they're singing. And with our hearts we'll hear them.
So when I think about Christmas, you know, we talk about Mary a lot, and obviously the angel comes to Joseph and tells him that Mary is pregnant. But I can't imagine, you know, what it feels like to hold the Savior of the world inside your arms. You know, and as a man who hopes to have kids one day, we'll see what happens. You know, I just can't imagine that feeling, that like just overwhelming like pride, first of all, that, hey, this is my son. And then also, he's going to save everyone. Now, I'm not exactly sure that they knew exactly what that meant yet. You know, Mary and Joseph knew that he was the Messiah, the promised one, but they didn't know what he was going to do. And so, the saying, you know, heavy is the head that wears the crown. You know, I can't imagine how it feels to have to raise Jesus. You know, how do you do that? And so, this song is called Joseph's Lullaby. This manger for your bed, you have a long road before you, rest your little head. Can you feel the weight of your glory? Do you understand the does the Father guard your heart for now so you can sleep tonight? Go to sleep, my son. Go and chase your dreams. This world can wait for one more moment.
Thank you, Travis. Today we light the candle of love. What is love? Well, let me share a story. I've shared it with you before, but one of the greatest examples of love I've ever seen in my own personal life. When I was a young child, probably a toddler at the time, my grandmother fell and broke her hip, which of course required surgery and then would require probably months of physical therapy. She refused to do the physical therapy. And so for the next 7 years of her life, she laid in bed. And throughout that 7 years, she had other health issues such as diabetes. She did not take care of herself. And so for the last probably 4 or 5 years of her life, she did not speak. She'd had a few minor strokes. She was unable to do anything for herself. And so for 5 years, I watched my grandfather take care of her every need. When she needed to be changed, when she was hungry, when she was thirsty, when it was time to wake up, when it was time to go to sleep, when it was time for her to change clothes, when it was time to bathe, he did everything for her. My grandfather was a little man, so he had one of those little lifts that would pick her up and move her over and set her in a chair, and then he would sit there and lovingly feed her every spoonful of food she ate for 5 years. And I watched this as a young man, and it meant the world to me, because although I really never got to know my grandmother, as I said, she didn't speak, she didn't move around, so I never really got to know her as a person. She passed away when I was 12 years old. I got to know my grandfather through those days and through those times. I got to watch as he lovingly cared for a person who, quite frankly, didn't take care of herself. In spite of some of the poor decisions she had made, he didn't sit there and fuss at her. He didn't yell at her and say, well, you shouldn't have done that. No, he cared for her every need, regardless of what happened in their lives. That's real love. It's sacrificial love. It's love that doesn't say, I told you so. It's love that doesn't walk away when it gets too hard. It's a love that continues to care even when it hurts and even when it's hard. And that's the love that Jesus has demonstrated to us. We walked away from him. We sinned. We broke his heart. We broke his commands. In fact, it was Jesus who told Adam and Eve not to eat of the fruit in the Garden of Eden, and yet they did it. It was Jesus who looked at Adam and Eve and said, what have you done? And it was Jesus who died on the cross thousands of years later to remedy that sin. Ezekiel chapter 34, verses 15 and 16. I will tend my flock and let them lie down. This is the declaration of the Lord God. I will seek the lost, bring back the strays, bandage the injured, and strengthen the weak. But I will destroy the fat and the strong. I will shepherd them with justice. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 31. For the Lord will not reject us forever. Even if he causes suffering, he will show compassion according to his abundant faithful love. For he does not enjoy bringing affliction or suffering on mankind. And finally, John 3:16. For God so loved the world in this way. He gave his one and only Son, that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. And so today, we light the candle of love. Let me pray for us first. Father, we praise you that in spite of our waywardness, in spite of our mistakes, in spite of our sin, God, you still care for us. And Lord, we just praise you, Father, that you care for us even as we go through pandemics, even as we go through difficulties in this world. Jesus, you died on the cross, and you're not going to waste that sacrifice. Father, I praise you that you're still at work in this world, and that you still love us, and you still love those who have wandered away. And Lord, my prayer is that our church would be a mighty part of bringing those people back, that you'd use each and every person in this room this Christmas season to go after those lost sheep, to go after those who have walked away. Father, we praise you, and we thank you for today. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you, as Travis and Aaron have said earlier this morning, for just allowing us to come to church, to not take this for granted, and that we can come and still worship. Lord, we're also thankful for the technology that allows those to stay home in safety and watch online. Lord, we know we're living in uncertain times, but you were in control. You were in control thousands of years ago, and you are still in control. We pray for your wisdom and we pray for your guidance. Lord, we pray for those during this Christmas season that this may not be the most exciting time of year for them. We pray for those that are sick, those that have health concerns, or those that have lost loved ones along the way. Lord, I especially thank you for this Advent season. In a world where we go through instant gratification, we want everything to happen now, Lord. I hope that we slow down and you prepare us for the greatest gift that any of us could receive, for your Savior, Jesus Christ. At this time, I ask that we bless these offerings and that you use them to further your kingdom and that we give with open hands and open hearts. In your name we pray. Amen.
So it's really hard to do Christmas music without Frank and Joanne, and so I miss you guys, but I understand their desire to take off until the end of the year, and so they will reassess at the beginning of 2021, and look, we're all in the same boat. If we don't feel comfortable, we don't feel comfortable, right? Right. So if you want to look at your hymnal, you can. The words will be on the screen. We're going to sing the first Noel, which is hymn number 180. We're going to sing the first two verses, and we're going to try to sing it a cappella. All right, so if I mess it up, don't hate me.
The first Noel, the angel did say, was to certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields as they lay, keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night that was so deep. No.
So I missed John and Rebecca and Cooper this morning. Aaron and I came into practice this morning, and I was like, well, we'll survive.
We'll survive. We did this for 6 months, just the two of us. We'll get through it.
Longest 6 months of my life. All right. So we're going to sing Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery is just a great song. I feel like we sing it a lot, but I love it, man. It's so good. So if you guys feel comfortable, feel free to sing.
Come behold the wondrous mystery in the dawning of the King. He the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our longing, in our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Come behold the wondrous mystery, He the perfect Son of Man. sure fulfillment of the law, in Him we stand. Come behold the wondrous mystery, Christ the Lord upon the tree, in the stead of ruined sinners, hangs the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption, see the Father's plan unfold, bringing many sons to glory, grace unmeasured, love untold. Come behold the wondrous mystery, slain by death, the God of life. But no grave could e'er restrain Him, praise the Lord, He is alive. What a foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering our hope. Christ in power resurrected, as we will be when He comes. What a foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering our hope. Christ in power resurrected, as we will be when He comes.
So this next song, I've always really liked it. You know, it's been a great Christmas song. I think I heard it like 3 years ago. Aaron sang it on a Sunday morning, and I really liked it. And I was like, man, I want to sing that. And then I tried to sing it this morning, and it was a little funky. So we're going to see how it goes. But it's called Noel, and Lauren Daigle sings it. She sings it much better than I do. And if you haven't heard it, her sing it, it's been on the radio. Please go listen to it so that it's not just me, and you'll be like, man, that song's awful. But go check it out. It's called Noel.
Love incarnate, love divine, star and angels gave the sign. Bow to babe on bended knee, the Savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, shall reign forevermore. Noel, Noel, come and see what God has done. Noel, Noel, the story of amazing love, the
Y'all can clap for him. He did a good job.
Thank you, Travis. No, you don't sing it like Lauren Daigle. You sing it better. Turn with me, if you would, to Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. What were you doing when you were 13 or 14 years old? I want you to think about it for a minute. And if you're 13 or 14 in the room, maybe you can answer the question a little more accurately than the rest of us. When I was 13 or 14, what was I worried about? How many points I'd score in the basketball game? Not many. I can just go ahead and fill in the blank. Not many. I was worried about how popular I would be. I wasn't. How funny I would be. I wasn't that either. I was worried about what my grades would be like. See, most of my concerns were for the next day, the next week, the next month. Now, at that point, I had started wearing glasses, so I realized my career choice, being an Air Force pilot, was out, right? Knew that wasn't going to happen. And my mom was saying, you need to be an engineer. And I was like, I hate math. That's a bad idea. And she goes, yeah, but you're good at it. And I said, yeah, but I hate it. Why would I do that? And so I had some sort of long-term, what am I going to do? But for the most part, my concerns were immediate. It was, what am I going to eat? You know, how am I going to play in the basketball game? Stuff like that. Not long-term questions. And for the majority of you, that's the case. Now, if you grew up on a farm or if you grew up working with your parents, maybe your concerns were a little more far out than mine. Maybe you were more concerned about the next step in life than I was. But for the most part, I would argue that at 13 or 14, you're enjoying being a teenager. And it's what you should be focused on. But when we come to Mary, we find a girl who was probably 13 or 14 years old, who is approached by an angel, which, by the way, when people see an angel in the Bible, they cower in fear. We see a 13 or 14-year-old girl petrified, terrified, in the presence of this angelic messenger being told, you're going to raise the Messiah. And by the way, I say 13 or 14, but she could have been as young as 12. And before you say, oh, well, that's how could they get married that early? Their lifespan was less than half of ours. So if you wanted to raise children, they had to start earlier. They would not be able to raise them to adulthood. And so Mary at 12, 13, 14, think about it. She might be a freshman in high school or an eighth grader, is told, you're going to raise the Messiah. Now, y'all know the song, Mary, Did You Know? No, she couldn't have possibly known all that. But she did understand the sacrifice that was required of her, at least in that moment. Did she understand that Jesus was going to die on a cross? No, probably not. Did she understand that Jesus was going to be thought of as crazy by his own family members and they wanted to take him home and lock him up? He was so crazy. No, she didn't understand that. Did she understand that he would be rejected by the world and beaten before her very eyes? No, she probably didn't realize that either. But what she did realize is all that raising the Messiah would take from her. You see, as an engaged 13, 14-year-old, her life was on the line. Her social standing was on the line. Not only could this ruin her reputation, but it could ruin the reputation of her parents and her entire family as well. You see, Mary is a very clear sign of what an obedient servant should be. Father, your will be done. And we're going to hear her say that, not those exact words. She says, may it be as you have said. But at some point, she realizes that she's not in control of her life. And if this is God's plan, then she'll submit to it, and she'll obey. And that's what we're called to do. And that's what love is. Sacrifice, obedience, even when it hurts sometimes. And so we're going to pick up in Luke chapter 1, and we're going to read verses 26 on and look at the birth of Jesus being foretold by the angel Gabriel to this young girl. And I want to keep repeating that because I want you to keep it in your mind. This 13 or 14-year-old girl speaking with this giant angelic messenger. Verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you. She was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end." And Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. Let's pray together. Father, we come here this morning, Lord, and we praise you for the opportunity to just come into your house and study your word. And Lord, encourage one another and pray for one another. Lord, I pray for those on the live stream, Father, that they wouldn't have any audio issues, that they'd be able to hear and participate in worship. And Father, I pray that each and every one of us would push aside distractions and come here to simply encounter you. And Father, that in Mary we would see not a perfect example, but an example of what it means to sacrifice, to obey, to love. Father, that we would look beyond Mary and see the Savior of the world in his obedience even to the point of death on a cross. Father, that we would be willing to take on the form of a servant as Jesus did, and meet the needs of the people around us that we might save some. Father, we praise you and we thank you for today. And I pray for those who are sick. I pray for those who are hurting. Lord, we pray that we would be an encouragement to each and every one of them. In your name we pray. Amen. In the sixth month of what? The sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy. Elizabeth is Mary's cousin. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth. Understand that when a being or a person comes from the presence of God, they glow. Is that necessarily important for the story? Not 100%, but it will be important to realize that a 13-year-old, 14-year-old girl turns around and there's a glowing giant figure in her room. So that adds to the fear factor of what is going on. Gabriel is sent from God. He is God's messenger. That's what angelos in the Greek means, messenger. God has sent a representative to this young girl in this nowhere town, in this nowhere area. Nothing important happens in Nazareth. Nothing important happens in Galilee. And yet this is where the Savior is going to be born. To a virgin, a young woman who has not known a man. Betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. Now understand what's going on here. Mary is betrothed. Now engagement in American society, you pull the ring off, you throw it at them, you're no longer engaged. Very easy to call off an engagement. But in this time period, you were legally married at this point. There's no separating from this person unless you go and get a bill of divorce or a certificate of divorce. So they're already married. It just hasn't been consummated yet. And they're not living together. Why? So what's happened is Joseph has gone to Mary's father. "I'd like to marry your daughter, Mary." And the father has said, "Okay, here's the bride price. Here's the dowry." Now we look at a bride price as buying someone. That's not what it is. You see, every member of the household was expected to contribute, to serve, to help, and they would help bring in income. The moment Mary leaves the father's household, he loses potential income from whatever work she would have helped her mother with. And so the bride price is saying, "You're going to lose this income for the next few years. Here's some money to help offset that so you can continue to run your household. Here's the bride price. Keep her safe for the next year. I'm going to go and prepare a place for us to dwell. I'm going to go and get my house in order. I'm going to go and set up my own household." By the way, sometimes we picture Joseph as a much older man. Picture 18, 19, 20 years old. So he's a college student. He's a college student getting ready to marry this 13-year-old. He has to go and get ready. Now, I don't know about you, but at 22 years old when I was getting ready to get married, I was nervous. What's going to be entailed? What's married life like? I couldn't imagine being in high school, or maybe middle school, going through those decisions. And so they already have all this stress on them. They already have all this worry on them. How are they going to set up, and where are they going to live, and what's Joseph's house going to look like? And he's already paid a substantial, this would have been months of wages for the bride price. So he's already paid this huge sum of money to marry Mary. So he goes away to prepare his house. And now this angel comes to this young girl, verse 28, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." That's a theologically rich statement. The Lord is with you. And Mary, who we see in Scripture, seems to be a good Jewish girl. She would have known her Scriptures. The first passage that comes into my mind is Joshua chapter 1. "Do not fear, the Lord is with you." Three times that idea is repeated in Joshua chapter 1. Joshua is going in to conquer the promised land, this impossible task. Jericho with walls that were 20 to 30 feet high and about 6 feet thick, and there's no trees to build ladders. God says the Lord is with you when something impossible is getting ready to happen that he's going to make possible. God says the Lord is with you when human insight, human wisdom, and human strength is getting ready to fall on its face. So when Mary hears the Lord is with you, wait a minute. What's getting ready to happen here? Why are you coming to me, this young girl? I'm betrothed to you. What in the world could God possibly want with me? Verse 29, she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. Is this a good thing or is it a bad thing? Who is this? Is it an angel? Is it not an angel? If it's not an angel, what's he doing in my house, in my room? She's scared. She has every right to be. Verse 30, the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid." That makes it worse. Right? Think about it for a minute. Don't be afraid. What's the first thing you're going to do? Be more afraid. It's like when the doctor tells you this will only hurt a little. Hold on. No, that means it's really, do not be. This giant figure, this towering figure comes and says, "Don't be afraid." Mary instantly is even more cranked up. But then he continues, "You have found favor with God." Now we need to back up and we need to put ourselves in Mary and in society's shoes. God has not spoken through a prophet in 400 years. This is a period of silence between the Old Testament and the New Testament. No written scripture has been produced between the ending of Malachi's ministry until now. Until John the Baptist shows up and starts preaching, really. For over 400 years, they had heard nothing from God. They were under Roman rule. They were being persecuted. And then, bam, your 13-year-old girl, you found favor with God. It's a shocking story. He could have gone to a priest. He could have gone into the temple. He could have spoken to anyone, and he chooses this young girl from the middle of nowhere with no sort of pedigree that would make her deserving of this honor. You have found favor with God. Now I want to be clear that word favor comes from the word for grace. It's not that she's done something super special to earn this. It's not like she's checked all the boxes and God's interviewing people from heaven, right? He's got his checklist. Well, they're out. No, they missed that. Mary's checked all the boxes. That's not what's happening. This is grace. This is a free gift. Mary, it's been 400 years, and now I choose to demonstrate my love and my mercy and my salvation to the nations through you. No, you don't deserve it. No, there's nothing super special about you, but I've chosen you. And we've been talking about that the last few weeks. There's nothing special in me that God would have chosen me for salvation. There's nothing special in Aaron that I deserve to stand up here as a pastor. There's nothing that I've done that's make me worthy of the honor to be your pastor and to preach Sunday after Sunday and to teach on Wednesday nights and to come in your homes and pray with you. It's God's grace. It's a free gift. He says, "Mary, I'm going to use you." Verse 31. You will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary has a few questions. The one big one being, how will this be since I am a virgin? Wait a minute, I'm going to what? I'm going to have a child? What are you talking about? I'm not married. Understand that during this betrothal period, if it was found out that the young girl had been unfaithful, that she was with child, the punishment under the law was stoning. That's the punishment. So in this moment, what he basically speaks over Mary in her mind is a death sentence. Maybe you hide it for the first few months. Maybe nobody will know for the first 3-4 months. But somebody's going to find out eventually. And when he tells her she will conceive and bear a child, what's everybody going to assume? Mary's been unfaithful. Not only that, but society, apparently, would often stone the young woman in front of her parents' household, in front of their house, to demonstrate the shame that was on them as well. The father has failed in protecting his daughter. So not only would it bring dishonor on her, but it would also bring dishonor on her family and her parents. It would tarnish their reputation. You will conceive and bear a son. How is this possible? I haven't been with a man. How can I bear a child? And he says, you shall call his name Jesus, which means Yahweh saves, or Yahweh is salvation. It's the Greek version of Joshua's name in the Old Testament. God is salvation. In the same way that God was going to work salvation through an imperfect man and rescue the Israelites from the people in Jericho and the Philistines and all the people they would overcome, God comes into this hopeless situation and says, Mary, I'm going to use you because I save. Because I'm all powerful. It's not about who you are. It's not about how special you are. It's about my grace and my mercy and the salvation that I will work. You see, this child's going to be different. Earlier in chapter 1, Elizabeth is told that her son will be great and that he will be a prophet of the Most High, Jesus' cousin, second cousin. But here we pick up and it says that he will be great. He will be called Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. 1,000 years earlier, God had promised King David, your offspring will sit on the throne. This is in 1 Samuel, if you want to go back and read it. Your offspring will sit on the throne forever. Who did David assume that would be? Who is David's offspring? Who is the next in line? King Solomon. So when David hears your offspring will sit on the throne forever, the immediate reaction, Solomon's going to sit on the throne forever? How is that possible? But we know according to the scriptures that King Solomon died. King Solomon was buried, as did his son, as did his son, as did his son. Was God's promise null and void? No. He will be called Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. You see, if you go back to verse 27, Joseph was of the house of David. And if we go back to the book of Matthew, Mary is actually of the house of David. From both sides of Jesus' family, he is of the right family. He is the root of David. He is the shoot of Jesse. He is the one that will come out and whose throne will know no end. By the way, the only other time we see Gabriel clearly in Scripture is in the book of Daniel, when he's talking about the end times, when he's talking about God's salvation for the nations and his punishment of wickedness. And here we have David once again, and what's he speaking about? The salvation of his people and the punishment of the wicked. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there will be no end. And Mary said to the angel, verse 34, how will this be since I'm a virgin? 13, I've never known a man. I've been a good Jewish girl. I haven't broken the law. How is this possible? Verse 35. The angel answered her, The Holy Spirit will come upon you. And the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of the Most God, the Son of God. In this way, Jesus is born without original sin. In this way, Jesus is born without a sin nature. In this way, Jesus is set apart. He's special. He's holy. Just as Adam was born of God and made with no sin nature, Jesus now comes in. And we're told throughout the New Testament that Jesus will right what Adam wronged. That Jesus will be set apart and he will live this perfect life so that we might be saved. Verse 36. Behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month of her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God. I don't know what you're dealing with right now. I don't know what you're struggling through. Some of you are dealing with health issues. Some of you have lost loved ones due to COVID or other ailments. Lost jobs. Maybe you're struggling financially. Maybe your family's falling apart. Maybe you're really upset your senior year or sports have been taken away from you. Maybe you're upset you can't see your family this Christmas. Maybe you're upset a lot of your traditions have fallen apart and they're not going to happen the way you wanted them to. And you look at this and you say, this is impossible. How in the world can this bring about good things? How in the world can all of this pain lead to something good? Well, we jump back to Romans chapter 8. God is working all things to the good, for the good, for those who are called according to his purpose. You see, in the midst of these struggles, God is not calling me to understand the hardships. God is not calling Mary to understand all the ramifications and how it will play out and what it will look like and what 10 years and 20 years and 30 years will bring. He doesn't reveal to her that her son's going to die on a cross, that he's going to be beaten, that he's going to be mocked, that he's going to be spit upon. He doesn't reveal to her that her children are going to think Jesus is crazy because she doesn't need to know that. What she needs to know is that right now, this is what God has called you to. Will you do it? Will you be obedient? Will you say, yes, Lord, I don't get it, but I'll follow you. Father, I don't understand what your plan is for COVID. I don't understand what your plan is for our politics and our country. I don't understand what the next few decades will bring. But I choose to trust you. And I choose to believe that you're working all things for the good. And I choose that my children are going to have the opportunity to praise you. And I choose to believe that their children will have that opportunity unless you come back soon, Father. I choose to believe that you've given me the opportunities to obey you even when it hurts. I choose to believe that you've given me the opportunity to love you as you loved us first. And this 13, 14-year-old girl looks back at the angel. When John encounters an angel, he falls on his face in terror twice. Not just once, but twice. This 13-year-old girl looks back at the angel. Behold, I am a servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. Can you say that today? No matter what you're going through, no matter what you're struggling with this Christmas season, Father, you gave this young girl the strength to say yes to this. You gave this young girl the courage to stand up in the face of all that she will go through, in the mocking and the looking down upon and risking her life. Father, you held it together for her so that she could honor you. God, I choose to believe that you will do the same for each and every one of us. When's this going to go away? When is 2020 going to end? Well, hopefully in a week or two, but there'll be another struggle behind it. I promise you there will be. COVID will be gone. It'll be a distant memory. But then there'll be some sort of political issue. Or there'll be another pandemic. I hope not. Or there'll be another financial crisis. Or there'll be another crisis in your family. Or there'll be another hardship at work. Or there'll be another difficulty, yada, 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 yada. Behold, I am a servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. God, I don't get it, but I choose to trust you. If you need to talk, if you're struggling, if you don't understand what God's plan is for your life, I might not be able to help you with the specifics on that. But I can share with you story after story of God's goodness, beginning in Genesis 1 and running all the way through the end of Revelation, looking specifically at the story of Christmas. How Jesus looked on the impossible. He looked on broken, wayward people who were fighting against his commands, who had rebelled against his leadership. And yet instead of giving up on us, he said, I'm going to do the impossible. I'm going to rescue these people even though they didn't ask me for it. I'm going to send my son through a 13-year-old girl, probably an 18-year-old husband, with no status in the world, no standing. Herod had stolen the throne, and so the line of David was destitute. I'm going to use these people whose society has forgotten, and I'm going to save the world through this young girl. I don't know what your life will bring, but I do know that if you'll choose to obey, and if you'll choose to be faithful, God will change the world through you, through one life at a time, through one soul, through one eternity. This Christmas, what are you doing? What are you doing with your family? Use the opportunity to tell them about a Savior. Use the opportunity to tell them about this family, this unlikely family in the book of, read the story in Luke chapter 2 to your family before you open presents. Remind them that while Santa's a great guy, his purpose is to tell us about the love of a Savior. Remind them that Jesus loves. And because of that, Jesus came to save the world, not to condemn the world, but to save the world through his own sacrifice. If you need someone to talk to or pray with, if you need to know what it looks like to accept Jesus as your Savior, I'm here. And I'd love to meet with you. Let me close this in prayer. Father, you are good. And you use the impossible to change lives and hearts and souls and minds. God, we praise you for this story of Christmas. We praise you that you used unlikely heroes and unlikely characters so that we might see ourselves, so that we might see our own brokenness and our own inability. God, you are good, and we praise you for today. And we ask you to use us throughout this Christmas season, that we would use this opportunity to proclaim your goodness, your love, your joy, your peace, your happiness, your hope to the nations. And Father, I pray this Christmas season that it would be a season of salvation. That while we turn to vaccines for physical health, Father, that our society would fall on its face and turn to you for hope. That there would be a revival in this nation. That there would be a revival in this state and in this community and in this world. God, that we might turn to you for hope. That we might turn to you for life. Lord, we praise you for Christmas. And we pray that we would be able to gather again in this place and worship your name soon. In your name we pray. Amen. Go and be blessed.